graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents the Nuclear Bombshell series, The Raven-Haired Rogue, by John Zakour, narrated by Richard Rowan, with performances by David Coyne, Nanette Savard, Deidra Starnes, Dawn Ursula, Nora Achrati, Tracy Oliveira, Yasmin Toison, Elizabeth Jernigan, Casie Platt, Alejandro Ruiz, James Lewis, Chris Genebach, David Jourdan, Michael Glenn, Elliot Dash, Michael John Casey, and Colleen Delany.
My name is Zachary Nixon Johnson. My beat is New Frisco. It's the year 2057, and I'm the last freelance private investigator on Earth. Yeah, I know that might sound a little apocalyptic to some and kind of cool to others, but truthfully, it's not apocalyptic at all. No catastrophe killed off the other freelance PIs. It's not like a meteor took out a global gumshoe convention or anything. It's just that these days, everything is wired to everything else. Information is readily available for just the cost of a few seconds of time on a search engine and a surcharge of a few credits. Your average first grader can dig up more information in a nanosecond than the best connected PI could have done just a few decades ago. That doesn't mean people still don't need PIs. After all, some information can be especially tricky to obtain. You know, the type of information that needs a special kind of extra poking and prodding around. The type of prodding that requires a personal touch and what I like to call extra sensitive persuasiveness. I call it that because it often requires finding a person's sensitive spot and squeezing. So yeah, even in this modern megatech world, there is still a demand for our services. In fact, being a PI can be quite profitable, at times. That's the other catch to being a freelance PI. If there's a nice profit to be made, you can bet big business will find a way to siphon off as much of those credits as possible. Today, there are two big private investigation companies. There's DICCO, which is run by entertainment ultra-mega corporation Entercorp, and there's IZRUS, owned by technology giant HTEC. A PI's life can be filled with violence and danger, making it a natural fit for the entertainment industry and reality HV. HTEC jumped into the game after it figured out that technology goes out of date, but lust and greed never do. Both of these big PI companies have the same MO. Potential clients contact them via their net sites. Then, if the company finds the client's plight interesting, i.e. marketable enough, it'll send out a team, all of which is broadcast live over one of the reality HV channels. It certainly takes the private out of private investigator, but some folks eat it up. Lucky for me, some clients still like to keep things more tight-lipped, which means I do get work. And when work arrives, it's usually quite interesting. Today's a slow day. I'm sitting back in my real leather chair in my office by the bay. I'm recounting the tale of one of my early PI adventures to my holographic assistant, Harf, and my flesh-and-blood assistant, Carol. There I was in the crowded theater looking for the e-blackmailer, and a mime and an android dressed as a mime were heading toward the crowd. I knew the mime was harmless, but the android had a bomb. I only had seconds to decide which one to take out.
So what did you do, Tio?
I shot them both with a heavy electric stun charge. Turns out I got more praise for stopping the actual mime than I did the android.
You don't have to be me, the most sophisticated cognitive processor on Earth, to know that mimes are truly annoying.
Harv may have a bit of an ego, but he's most likely correct on both accounts. Mimes can be quite annoying, and Harv is probably the most sophisticated computer around. Yeah, sure, these days, pretty much everybody over the age of 3 wears a portable interactive holographic interface personally optimized device, or a PiPod for short. And yeah, these devices do allow easy access to a constant wealth of information. They even have all their own rudimentary personalities, such as the Bob, Betty, Bunny, and Bubba models. Thing is, none of these canned artificial personalities are a changing, constantly evolving intelligence like Harv is. Turns out most people are very uneasy about having a computer interface that has more personality than they do. Of course, it doesn't help that Harv can be a bit sarcastic at times, plus the fact that he loves to appear as a snobbish, balding British butler doesn't exactly endear Harv to the average Joe or Jane Doe. Oh, I should mention that Harv is physically connected to my brain. Having an Ultramega supercomputer wired to my cerebral cortex lets me have constant access to pretty much all the information in the known worlds. It allows Harv to tap into my body and the Under Armour I wear to let me move faster, take more damage, and punch harder than other humans. I can project holograms from my left eye lens, which is pretty sub-zero. On the downside, I have a nosy supercomputer constantly critiquing my every move.
Zach, I'm picking up a vibe.
Carol's bright green eyes pop open. She puts her fingers to her forehead and leans forward, her long golden brown hair dropping down her shoulders. I swear she starts to glow with energy. I should note that Carol is a Class 1, Level 7 Psi, which means she can do things with her mind that most people only dream of.
You are about to get a call from the Kardashian Towers Hotel. The vibe's message isn't totally clear, but I do know he, she, or it wants you to find a dog from Mars.
I don't usually find pets, even ones from Mars.
From what I understand, the client wants to pay 1,000,000 credits.
Of course, there's a first time for everything.
Zach, you have a call coming in from Marinda 1616. Do you wish to accept it as a hologram or on the wall screen?
This is obviously the vibe Carol had. I take my feet off my real oak desk. I sit up and straighten my jacket. Even though my office is meant to look much like the typical gumshoe's office from 100 years ago, looks can be deceiving. I have all the modern necessities. Wall screens equipped with full-room holographic projectors and a laser defense system. Believe me, when you're me, a laser defense system is a necessity. Left wall screen, please. The image of a regal-looking woman with long black hair fills my left wall. Her dark hair is made more striking by her creamy white skin. She holds her head high, and her piercing green eyes are locked on the screen, unwavering. She's probably a little older than I am, but not much.
Mr. Johnson, thank you for taking my call. I am Marinda 1616. I'm part of the High Council of Mars.
Remember, Zach, people from Mars, well, Martians, all use numbers for last names. They believe it gives them solidarity.
Did I mention that Harv can talk directly to me inside my head yet? Well, he can. It comes in handy a lot more than I thought it would. The pleasure is mine, Marinda. What brings you to Earth?
I'm here trying to negotiate a trade between Earth and the Mars colony. As I'm sure you are aware, we on Mars make the finest handcrafted goods in the known worlds.
Yes, my assistant Carol has one of your scarves that she raves about. So, to what do I owe the pleasure of your call?
I want to hire you to find my dog and dearest companion, Saturn. He's a special creature.
I sit back in my chair and prop my hands behind my head.
Oh?
Yes, very special. His IQ is well over 200, and he can communicate telepathically.
Now that is special. When did he go missing?
A couple of hours ago. He said his hotel was too stuffy and that he needed some fresh air. He left, and that's the last I heard from him. I wanted to send a security person with him, but he insisted that he's a big boy. Please, Zach. You have to find him. I'll pay 100,000 credits in advance and another 100,000 credits when you find him.
Okay. Not exactly the 1,000,000 credits Carol thought it would be, but even the best size aren't perfect. Besides, 200,000 credits to track down a dog isn't a bad payday.
Sure, I'll do it.
I'm staying on the 13th floor of the Kardashian Towers. Come here and I'll give you all of Saturn's pertinent information.
Sounds like a plan. When tracking down a subject, it's always helpful to see his or her last known surroundings. I may get a clue. I should be there in 20 minutes.
I look forward to meeting you.
Marinda nods, and my wall screen goes blank. I turn to Carol.
Ready for a little road trip?
Sorry I was wrong about the amount.
Nobody's perfect. Not even you.
I walk over to my actual wood coat rack and take my fedora off the top.
Oh, why must you always insist on wearing that hat when you start a case?
It helps set the proper tone. Being a PI is as much about attitude as anything else.
It's a nice sunny day on the New Frisco Pier. A few tourists dot the street, taking 3D photos of themselves standing by the water like it's some great accomplishment. Three other tourists, a man, a woman, and a kid, are ogling my 1973 cherry red Mustang. Now these are people with taste. The small kid with red hair and freckles looks up at me.
Is this really your vehicle, sir?
It is.
How quaint and archaic.
I notice that Dad has an old pipe in his front pocket, which is weird. Hardly anybody smokes these days, especially not from an old-fashioned style pipe.
Harv, scan these folks. They look too much like a 1950s sitcom family to be real. Harv appears, projecting himself from my wrist communicator.
These people are all wearing holographic disguises.
The kid looks at Harv and smiles.
Wow, you really are as good as people say!
The three family members each touch a button on his or her respective belt. I'm now standing face to face, well, face to chest, with three big apes in expensive suits. And I'm not talking metaphorically here. These are three actual apes. These days, if some companies have messages they want to deliver in a hard-to-ignore package, they use actual apes. Apes are big and intimidating, and they haven't unionized like human and mutant muscle. Plus, they're easier to maintain than android muscle. And when push comes to shove, apes are scarier than androids. Still, I'm not one to scare easily. I lock eyes with the biggest ape, figuring he or she is the leader, my thought process being that I could stare him or her down.
Dude, we each outweigh you by a good 100 kilos, and we're freaking apes carrying heat.
The other two apes open their jackets to reveal very big sidearms. Your point being?
Plus, we're each wearing really expensive psi blockers, so Carol can't warp us with her mind.
Your point being? The lead ape opens his arms and lifts his hands. It's meant to be a friendly gesture.
We just want to talk.
Zach, I've tapped into the apes' communication devices. They seem to be in the employ of a new reality HV network called Actual Real Reality HV Net.
Listen, guys, I'm flattered. But like I told all your competition, I'm not doing reality HV. The three apes look at one another. What's so funny?
Dude, we don't want you. We're not just the muscle here, we're also the brains of this new HV network. We see things differently than humans. You're old news and, well, old. What are you, 40 now? We're targeting a young sub-zero demographic.
He points to Carol and Harv.
We want them. The girl is beautiful, so guys will dig her, but she's powerful, so women will get behind her. Plus, she has that it factor. The hologram, well, he's the perfect snooty sidekick. People will love to hate him.
He's far from perfect.
I'm not snooty. I'm merely confident in my knowledge.
Harv tosses his head back.
I am also definitely not a sidekick.
I like to keep my life as private as possible.
I get it. I understand not wanting to stand out.
This coming from a big ape in a pink suit.
Our suits and ties have interactive nano-colors that we can adjust for the circumstance. We thought the pink would be friendlier, but that's neither here nor there. My point is that our terms are very reasonable and generous.
He touches the pie pod on his ear, and a holographic contract appears.
All you have to do is live your lives and let us record it.
I've scanned the terms. They are reasonable. But Carol and I are not a sideshow. When you do it,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.